What's up, everybody? Welcome back to the Post-Gazette Sports Now YouTube channel. She is Abby Schnabel. I'm Noah Hiles, and Abby, very eventful week in the world of college athletics here in Western Pennsylvania. We could start with the transfer portal, which today is day 60 for the basketball season, but that's definitely not the biggest college basketball story in this general area, unless you've been living under a rock. Bob Huggins, probably, I don't know, top 10 most notable coaches in college basketball right now, somewhere in that. A Hall of Famer made a big mistake earlier this week on Monday on a radio hit with a pair of DJs in Cincinnati. I don't know, some local sports talk show there said more than a few words, more than a few times, that one shouldn't say privately or publicly. Yep. But he said it on radio and
multiple times.
Yeah, and it caused quite a controversy, as it should have. I'm not going to reiterate that audio because I like my job and I don't have $1 million of a salary to be deducted from. So I'm just going to let you, anyone watching this, go and look that up if they haven't listened already. But Abby, I just, we don't necessarily need to debate the punishment. But I just wanted to get your thoughts on the entire situation. I mean, how it unfolded, how WVU handled it, and what do you think? I mean, will anything else come from this? Or now that the punishment's been dealt, is this kind of the end of it?
I think it's going to be kind of one of those things that people are going to ask Huggins about, like, all season.
Really?
Unfortunately, yeah. So, and I'm going to put that into perspective because not as big of a scandal, but my first year on the Wisconsin beat, there was a released audio tape from a private meeting with Greg Gard and the seniors. And that was something that was the narrative the entire season. And that happened in June. It was June 23rd was when the audio was released. And the audio from the meeting was from a meeting back in January. And that was the narrative the entire season. And was like, how'd you deal with this? How did you work on relationships? And blah, blah, blah. The whole season, even though they had one of the best players in the country in Johnny Davis, even though that they were winning, defying odds, defying
expectations. Yeah, they won the league.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And so I think this is something that's going to kind of follow him. The only difference is I think Bob Huggins is the kind of guy to just not, like, even – entertain it. Yeah. So I think I think it's going to be something that's asked about and talked about on the outside level all season. However, I don't think it's something that Huggins is going to entertain, and I think it's something WVU is going to kind of try and brush under. Is not the right word I want to use, but yeah. And so that's what I wanted to start with, but I think it's just crazy the timeline of everything, just because this radio show happened in the morning.
Yeah.
And no one knew anything of it until
the afternoon. I mean, how many people are listening? West Virginia fans are listening to Cincinnati radio hit. I mean, it take a while for someone to clip it and send it over to a beat reporter who could post it.
But if I'm Bob Huggins and I know that I just said that on radio, I'm getting in front of the issue because we're in an era of, you can find just about anything.
And that's where I'll interrupt you, because that's my biggest thing is, by the way he said it, and you mentioned the timing, I don't think he thought he did anything wrong. And I think he recognizes now that he messed up. But just the way that he casually went that route with his rhetoric, and the fact that, I mean, maybe I'm not Bob Huggins. I wasn't with Bob Huggins Monday. I've never been with Bob Huggins. But I don't know. It just seems like he just said that, like he was having a casual conversation with two people he's probably known for a long time. I mean, he coached in Cincinnati before West Virginia. He's been at WVU forever, it seems. I mean, I grew up watching him coach at WVU when I was like in high school and stuff. So it's been 10 plus years. But yeah, I mean, those are two Cincinnati show hosts that have probably known Bob Huggins for decades, and they probably made jokes like that, and off air, and had comfortable conversations or conversations where they felt comfortable just letting whatever fly. And I think that that's my takeaway, was he was just shooting the breeze with his boys on the radio. And I don't think he recognized what he did was wrong until it kind of surfaced on social media. And again, I could be wrong. But if I'm wrong, then if he recognized it, then like you said, Abby, like, why didn't he get ahead of it? Because like that's clearly going to surface. And my question more was, I don't think any party involved in that situation recognized the wrong that had occurred, because you didn't see the radio station be proactive. You didn't see either one of those hosts go out and say something before it surfaced. I mean, that's something where you would think if that went over your airwaves, you're addressing that. You're probably ending that segment early and you're addressing it. You're going to a break, gathering your thoughts, and you're saying the very next segment, hey, something happened here. We don't condone that, whatever.
And you're not ending the segment with saying that Bob Huggins, he's the best.
Yeah. And that's, yeah, that was my big takeaway. It was like, I really don't think he understood what he said was that offensive. That does not make it okay. Well, it's actually kind of mind blowing that how do you live in a world, in today's world, where you know you don't understand that, hey, you shouldn't say that anywhere, especially on the freaking radio when you're Bob Huggins. That was my big takeaway.
And then the continuing with the timing aspect of it all, you know, he puts out a statement. West Virginia is like, oh, this is under review, which a lot of people are like, what are we reviewing? We all heard this, which unfortunately made me feel like they were trying to see public reception before they made a decision.
1,000% what they're doing,
which is, you know, frustrating, because this is something that should have been. Not waiting to see what people thought. This is something that should have been condemned from the very beginning, and taken action with. And then when you look at like his punishments, I mean, suspended first three regular season games, returns in time for the Fort Myers tip off. Cause of course they probably don't want to risk, oh, we want our head coach there to potentially win a trophy. Amended his contract from multi-year to year to year. His contract was up for renewal in June anyway. You know,
on but he probably wasn't taking a pay cut.
Oh, that's fair. You know, the yeah. I love the $1 million annually to support LGBTQ practices, donating money to Xavier required LGBTQ plus training. And that if he says anything like this ever again, he's immediately terminated. I like all of those actions. I don't know. It just felt like if this happened to many other coaches, they'd be done.
Yeah.
Even some of the maybe more tenured coaches.
This happened to Neil Brown, he'd be done. Yeah. If it happened to their football coach, they would fire him immediately because they want to fire him, but they don't want to pay out that payout clause. But this is Huggy Bear. And this is just to butt in here. I mean, this is college sports. There are a handful of people who can get away with this. And it depends on a multitude of factors. And unfortunately, none of them are actually what was said. It's like, how are our boosters going to react to this? How will our local media cover this? And will this person's legacy be able to overcome this? And West Virginia didn't take a lot of time to figure out that this is not going to, you talked about how you thought it was going to be something where this is going to follow them all year. Abby, there are people in West Virginia who will not remember why Bob Huggins is suspended for the first three games of the season once this season rolls around. And I'm not talking just like casual fans. I'm talking there are people close to the program. Oh, that's right. He said that. That's why he's suspended. I forgot about that. Like I genuinely think they might bring it up to him his first media availability. I think by the time Pitt and West Virginia play on December 6th in basketball, this will be gone. It will be brought up by Pitt fans with signs and whatnot. But this is, I don't like putting any area or fan base or you know, university in a box or anything. But I just think that based off of the reaction here, I think that West Virginia kind of determined that, look, we can survive whatever PR storm that we're going to have to encounter. Because at the end of the day, I think if you were to poll everyone who funds West Virginia athletics, who supports West Virginia athletics, who's a part of West Virginia athletics, they didn't want to see Huggy Bear go over this. Yeah. And that's ultimately who they're aiming to please. And I just think that, yeah, he was never going to be fired from this. He was never going to be fired from this. You know, and I think it's crazy, you know, like, cause like you said, if Jeff Capel said this, I think this is a totally different situation. If, you know, Micah Strewsbury said this when he was at Penn State, or, you know, any other, most of them, any other college basketball coach, you're probably not surviving this.
Yeah.
But I will say, you know, I'm not here to debate if the punishment was enough or not. $1 million is a lot of freaking money. And three games, I get that, yeah, they're early in the year, but I mean, what are they going to do? Are they going to suspend him? I don't think anyone in their right mind would wait until conference play to make that suspension. Yeah. That would have to be something done by the Big 12, which I don't think that league has the authority to do. But yeah, just a stupid thing to do.
Well,
and very disappointing.
And it's crazy too, because when you look at like the headlines about West Virginia basketball today, all about their top rated transfer portal class.
Yeah.
It's like, man, we moved on from that real fast.
Well, that's, you know, and like, I'm not here to call out anyone on the West Virginia beat or whatever. Yeah. I don't know really anyone who covers West Virginia that well. But I know, like, if I was covering WVU, yes, this would be something I would look into further. This would be a big, this just gave me something to write about in the summertime is how I would be looking at this. But I don't think that's the mentality there, because, and I think part of it might be, it's not what their fans want to read about. And I don't know. It's just a different thing, a whole different situation. It was very interesting to follow. Unfortunate on all fronts. Unfortunate that we live in a world where words like that are still used like that publicly, where, you know, we live in a world where a media outlet didn't immediately check him when he said that, that a guy like Bob Huggins, for my money, from everything that I've noticed, seems like a decent human being. You don't hear a lot of bad things about him from former players. That would be so dumb to make that type of mistake and put a stain on his resume and his legacy, and that West Virginia will be judged externally. I don't think internally, or maybe even inside the state of West Virginia, but they're going to be judged by how they handle this. And it's just a bad situation that, you know, there are words out there that can be said and cause all of this. It's very unfortunate. Just sucks. It sucks that this is a part of our world.
Yep.
Yes. Not in a sense where it's like, I'm not advocating that you should be able to say whatever you want. I'm saying that it sucks that, mm-hmm. you know, there are words that have this negative attachment that can hurt so many people. That's what I'm against. To be clear, for the record, don't like saying slurs of any nature. Noah Hiles, I'm on that bandwagon. We'll move forward now.
You summed it up perfectly.
I try. Carry on. I hate talking about this stuff. I think anyone who knows me at all gets an idea of like where I stand on everything like that. But just, I don't know. It's pretty cut and dry to me. And I think the longer anyone talks about it, as far as analyzing the situation rather than, you know, forcing Huggins or West Virginia to talk more about it, it's not doing any good. So that's where I would use my platform. But I don't interview Bob Huggins very often. Never actually spoke to him in my life. So moving forward now, the transfer portal, we're recording this on Thursday. Final day, day 60 of the portal. I feel like about 40,000 athletes, basketball players have entered and, you know, found a new team or are still looking for a new team. It's been crazy, but it's also been very interesting to cover. I only cover Pitt. Abby, you cover like five schools in this area. And they've all kind of had different off seasons. You look at it, Penn State, total roster reconstruction. That's mm-hmm. what happens when you lose your head coach and you lose three of the better players your program has seen in the past decade plus, just from graduation. West Virginia has had a crazy offseason as far as bringing in like big name talent from the portal. And Pitt's been a little bit more selective with the limited roster spots that they had to offer. They've kind of been able to pick and choose. They've only had three official visits. And we'll just go through them now, all, Abby. I mean, Pitt with two new players through the portal, West Virginia with five, Penn State with seven. When you look, I mean, who do you think is the biggest get out of any of these teams right now?
Oh, man. West Virginia killed it in the transfer portal.
They did.
I mean, Kirk Crissa, Arizona, or Jesse Edwards, Syracuse are probably my top are probably my top two. No specific order. That's just how I wrote them on my list. And I don't think it even comes close after that. I think that those two.
And were- I'll add, I think the third best player out of these three teams that we're talking about is Raekwon Battle from Montana State. He's not as known because he didn't play for Arizona or Syracuse to, you know, borderline blue blood programs. But I had a chance to see Raekwon Battle play. They played Providence in the first round or Kansas State. No, they played Kansas State in the first round because Kentucky played Providence. I watched both those games. They were in Greensboro. This guy's a baller. And the acquisitions that West Virginia made in this portal, the new players they brought in, they got a new point guard, they got a new wing, and they got a new big man. And they're all studs. I mean, Battle, 17.7 points a game. I mean, Edwards was first team all defense. Yeah, and led the ACC in blocks, 10-plus rebounds a game. And Kirk Crissa, I mean, you're looking at one of the best natural point guards probably in the country next year. Mm-hmm. They've had an incredible transfer portal, which also probably might have had something to do with why they didn't want to get rid of Bob Huggins. West Virginia's absolutely killed it this offseason.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, they have the top rated transfer portal class per multiple outlets, tied with Kansas, with Kansas getting Hunter Dickinson. That kind of raises your stock a little bit. Yeah. But I mean, I really just feel like that West Virginia attacked it. And they were like, listen, there's opportunities here where you can come in and start and be a star here. Because they are coming off of a little bit of a down year for them. I know that's weird saying because they did go to the NCAA tournament. But, you know, they tend to be a little bit better. And I think this class is really going to come in and help. And I just – fantastic. Like, those top three, like you said, was just all around. And then after that, like, if I had to go fourth, I'd probably say Penn State picking up Puff Johnson. That was huge.
I would say Ace Baldwin from VCU. Adrian Baldwin, Ace Baldwin.
That's a good one,
too. He is a fantastic point guard. I think he'll be the star of that team next year. Puff's a good pickup. But just to talk more about WVU, too, I think that's the big takeaway from here is West Virginia played to about its potential last year, I think.
Yeah.
Where it was well coached. I mean, it was a team that in that league, they did not match up talent-wise with many of the teams in that league at all. They were outmanned and outgunned, but still found a way to get their, you know, ticket to the dance as like an 8 or a 9 seed. I forget exactly what they were. But I think they looked around and said, no, we are not going to be able to continue doing this in this league. We need to have star power. And they had a little bit of it last year with Stevenson and other guys, but they went out and they have the horses now that they have a guy who can guard Hunter Dickinson. They have guards who can run with whomever Baylor wants to run the floor with or TCU wants to push the pace with. They have wings who can be athletic and go up against whatever 5-star freshman, you know, you see in the Big 12. And that's what stands out to me here. I think it's also a testament to West Virginia's NIL collective and how far ahead it is that in that aspect compared to Pitt and Penn State, who, you know, we saw them in the mix for some of these guys or players of their caliber, and they ultimately did not come close to landing them. And I think that West Virginia was able to get a guy like Edwards or Kirk Crissa because the NIL on top of playing in the Big 12 and everything else made it too good of an opportunity to pass up.
Well, and what's crazy too is when you look at it, like last year, Penn State and Pitt were able to go to the NCAA tournament because of the guys they got out of the transfer portal, whether that be the season before or two seasons
before. And same for West Virginia. West Virginia's best players came from the portal too.
Absolutely. I think that's just the day and age we're in. And I just think it's so interesting with how West Virginia was able to just be like, hey, look, Eric Stevenson came here and became a star.
Right.
You could do that. And you know, and I feel like Pitt and Penn State probably use that too. Like, you know, Jamarius Burton, Jalen Pickett, they came here and they became a star. Also, this is teasing an article I'm working on for next week about the transfer portal and all of that. And it's just, it was probably with the success of last year, I would have expected Pitt to do get a little bit more of that star power just because, like, look, our top guys are transfer guys. Penn State's a different situation. New coach changes things a little bit. But I mean, I think all three teams did pretty well West Virginia is just like light years above the other two.
I think Penn State did. I mean, there's a difference in situations here also where Pitt could be picky because they have a lot of key pieces returning. And I think it's very clear that Pitt's highly invested in this freshman class they have coming in.
Absolutely.
With the 2 4-star guards and the 3-star wing that they have, and with Dior coming back and just what they have returning with Henson and the twins and Fetty, they thought, you know, we just need a couple pieces. And that's why I don't think we've seen them as aggressive as opposed to last year. They were in a similar spot to Penn State where it's like, we have to rebuild our entire roster. And when you're doing that, especially with Penn State, they are kind of put to a disadvantage because they had to hire a head coach. And so you're just grabbing guys who are just filling spots on a roster, for lack of a better term. And they might be productive players, but at the end of the day, it's like, we've got 7 spots on this bench to fill. We can't put all of our effort and energy into one guy right now. And so that's where you see some lesser known names for Penn State. And I'm not acting like the guys that Pitt brought in are, you know, no one was staying up late at night to watch Zach Austin or Ishmael Leggett, or not many people, I would say, on a Tuesday night in February. But I think that those guys came in to build around what's already there.
Absolutely.
At Pitt, where West Virginia said, we're going to take things to the next level. And Penn State's just like, we just need to rebuild something. It's very interesting because Pitt was in a completely opposite situation last year. And it's crazy to think that they're confident enough in this foundation that they built in a year to think that, oh, this is the way. This is the way to go about it. And it's a reasonable way to think when you look at kind of how their roster is right now.
I think all three teams did a really good job of recruiting to what they needed, in that West Virginia lost some of its top guys. They needed to rebuild, but they had the leg to rebuild via star power.
Yeah.
Penn State needed to rebuild, but a brand new coach means that you gotta, like you said, kind of fill in spots. But even like, mentioning Puff Johnson, Ace Baldwin, even Kudus Wahab, who used to play for Maryland, has Power 5 experience. Like, I don't think he did a bad job. Like, I felt like he was strategic about who he wanted to fill his spots. I mean, bringing in 2 guys from VCU is easy, just because you know them. Now you don't have to teach them. And then, like you said, Pitt has a lot of its star power, has a lot of its puzzle pieces in place already, and they got to be picky. And so all three teams had different kind of goals, and you might measure, I mean, West Virginia no doubt has the best class of the three, but all three schools did what they needed to
do. All got better.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I think that out of right now, looking at what's still needed, I think Pitt has the most work to do right now.
Yes.
Just because they had to rebuild their whole backcourt, and while they have a lot of talent, they actually might have a more talented backcourt next year than this year, which is really saying something. They don't have any experience. They have 1 guard right now on their roster that's played in a college basketball game. Yep. And that's not a good recipe for success if you look at the teams that went in March. So I think landing another veteran guard would be huge for them. Missing out on Noah Thomason was a big loss for Pitt. But these other two teams, I mean, Penn State, like, do I look at this roster and I think that this is going to be a Penn State team that's better than last year's team? No. But when I say it got better, I think they're in a better spot than what they really could have been in.
Yeah.
Considering all of what they had to handle this offseason. So,
absolutely.
Abby, I think that's all we got for today. Any final thoughts?
No, I love college basketball. I was at the Pitt West Virginia baseball game yesterday, and there was a talking about buying your season tickets. And I was like, we're already talking about it. We're already getting ready for the season, and it's not even until November. And absolutely. I love it.
There we go. Well, hit that subscribe button if you haven't already, and keep tuning into the Post Gazette Sports Now YouTube channel. We've got analysis on all your Pittsburgh and Western Pennsylvania area teams every day. 365, 24/7, however you want to say it. We talk a lot about them here on the Post Gazette Sports Now YouTube channel. Take care.
Thank you for checking out this content from Post Gazette Sports. If you liked the video, please like it and subscribe to our YouTube channel. If you enjoyed it on Apple Podcasts, please rate us 5 stars on Apple Podcasts. For 6 months of digital access to post-gazette.com for just $6, click the link down in the description.